Saturday Morning Physics is sponsored by the Physics Department of the University of Michigan, by the Dr. M. Lois Tiffany Endowment, and by gifts from friends of the program.
This is very scary, you know, for a mathematician, you know, 20 is a big crowd, so. But when I was thinking of preparing for this talk, I was reminded of the old joke about the physicist, the mathematician, and the engineer, and then I thought I had to tell the clean joke about the physicist, the mathematician, and the engineer, and the engineer wakes up, and there's a fire in his room, and he goes get some water, and he puts it out, and the physicist wakes up, there's a fire in his room, and he figures out exactly how much water is needed to put it out, goes, pours exactly that amount of water, and goes, puts the fire out. Mathematician wakes up, sees there's a fire, he sees there's water, satisfied that there's a solution, he goes back to bed. So, oh, I got a million of them. Anyway, so where we talk about I'm going to introduce non-Euclidean geometry for you, and then to get a feeling for it, we're going to talk about what it is to live in non-Euclidean geometry, to understand the space. So this is sort of the opposite of physics. I mean, in physics, you start with your space, and you're living in it, and you try to figure out what the rules are. Here, I'm going to give you the rules, then we're going to figure out what it's like to live there. So what is a geometry? It's kind of a cool picture my friend made. Well, a geometry just loosely is a space with a way of measuring distances and angles. So we're used to this typically, like in a Euclidean space where we presumably live, the distance between two points is the length of the shortest path. So whenever you have a way of computing the distance of the path, you can define a distance. You can just sort of say the distance between two points is the length of that shortest path. So. Don't worry, there'll be two integral signs on the board. It's not going to be very much of that going on. So in Euclidean space, we have this nice so-called arc length formula. You just integrate the speed. So if you don't like the word integral, all you do is you see if you're going 60 miles per hour for 1 minute, then you travel 1 mile. And for the next minute, you're traveling 30 miles. You travel half a mile, and then you travel a mile and a half in those 2 minutes. And that's roughly what that integral means. Okay, and so there's just a few facts for comparison about Euclidean space to remind you. The area, the radius of a ball is r, its area is pi r squared, it grows quadratically, and its circumference, which is just the length of the circle, is 2 pi r, it just grows linearly. And one thing you should notice here is that the area of the ball is growing much faster than the circumference. And one thing that means is that most of the area is near the middle, not out near the boundary. So what I want to talk about is non-Euclidean or hyperbolic geometry, and it's going to live in the unit disk, just the set of points inside that little ball of radius 1, but I'm going to give you a different formula for finding the length of a path. And once you have a different formula for finding the length of the path, then you can, hey, you have a different distance because you look at the length of the shortest path using this new formula. Okay, so that's the formula. I'm not going to do any calculations with the formula. It's just up there for honesty's sake. And so you just, instead of integrating the Euclidean speed, you integrate the hyperbolic speed. And the hyperbolic speed is just the Euclidean speed scaled by some number, which is the closer you get to the boundary, you scale by dividing by a smaller and smaller number. So as you get, what actually happens in this, which is sort of surprising, is that as you walk towards the boundary, it's going to take you an infinite distance to get to the boundary. So the circle actually isn't in hyperbolic space. It's an infinite distance away. Okay. And then you can figure out what the lines are in this geometry. So lines are just the shortest way to get from one point to the other. So if I give you this notion of measuring the length of the path. You could do a bunch of calculations and figure out what the shortest paths between two points are. And those shortest paths turn out to be exactly circles or lines which are perpendicular to the boundary. And let me remind you again, those lines, when we're living in hyperbolic space, have infinite length, even though our Euclidean eyes insist on seeing them with finite length. And one thing you'll notice in that, supposed to use the cursor here. Look at this one here. Passing through that point, there are all these different lines which do not intersect this line over here. So that was the first reason that this was considered to be an interesting geometry. It's because in Euclidean space, if I give you a point and I give you a line, there's a unique line through that point which doesn't intersect the other line. This is Euclid's parallel postulate. Okay. So, this slide just says all that. And this was actually what home mathematicians in the 20th century tried to prove Fermat's last theorem, and home mathematicians in the 18th century attempted to prove that the parallel postulate, which is that if you give a point and a line, there's a unique parallel line passing through that point, followed from the first four of Euclidean's axioms. That's actually what Lewis Carroll spent most of his time doing when he wasn't writing through the looking glass. Early in the 19th century, both Janusz Bolyai and Lobachevsky independently discovered hyperbolic geometry and showed that the parallel postulate failed. And while Bolyai was working on the parallel postulate, his father wrote to him, and this is, I think, words of wisdom for all young mathematicians and perhaps physicists too, though I wouldn't presume. For God's sake, I beseech you, give it up. Fear it no less than sensual passions, because it too may take all your time, deprive you of your health, peace of mind, and happiness in life. Look at me, very unhappy. So then you can also do some other calculations. We're not going to do any calculations, though, and find what is the area of a ball in hyperbolic space. Well, it turns out to be 2 pi times the hyperbolic cosine of r minus 2 pi. But let's not worry about that. What that is roughly is pi times e to the r. So e is just some number. Well, it's kind of an important number, but for these purposes, about 2.718. So that grows really fast, right? If you remember, already 2 to the 5 is 32, and 2 to the 10 already has 4 digits, and et cetera, et cetera. So this grows quite a bit fast. E to the r grows quite a bit faster than pi r squared. And this is going to tell you there's an awful lot of real estate in hyperbolic space. So for instance, if New York City were in hyperbolic space, everybody could live right near downtown. So this is a nice feature of hyperbolic space. But we're going to actually it depends what kind of person you are, right? If you would like to escape downtown, it's not so good. And another thing you notice, the circumference, or the length of the circle of radius r, is 2 pi times hyperbolic sine of r. Again, that's roughly pi e to the r. So that means that the length of the circle is about the same as the area of the ball. This is very different than in hyperbolic space. Than in Euclidean space. And one thing it means is that most of the area of a ball is right out near the boundary. Okay, so these are the two facts we're going to use. So you really don't have to know anything else about hyperbolic space for the next little bit, except these two facts. We're going to see what impact do those facts have on living in hyperbolic space. So here's the actual calculation. So if you have a Euclidean ball of radius 100, it's about 30,000 square feet. So that's maybe roughly about the size here of this building. Now, if you have a hyperbolic ball of radius 100, its area has 40 digits. So it's rather a bigger place. Okay. And here's another famous Escher print. Actually, it doesn't, looks a little fuzzy. Anyway, does it look fuzzy from out there?
Yes.
Hmm. Well, I'll just give me a few minutes, I'll fix that. No. Escher was an artist who sort of used hyperbolic geometry in designing his things, in designing his pieces. Artists don't like it when you call their work things, I found. All those fishes have exactly the same size from a hyperbolic viewpoint. So you can see those little yellow fishes, and there's supposed to be a lot of little, on my screen, I can see lots of little yellow fishes accumulating the boundary of exactly the same size. So this is like you might take a gigantic chessboard, would be a tessellation of the Euclidean plane by squares of exactly the same size. This is a tessellation of the hyperbolic plane by fishes of exactly the same size. Okay. So the question I want to talk about here for the next little bit is, using this information that we didn't compute, what is it like to live in the hyperbolic plane? And we're going to use sports to sort of figure that out. So how about baseball? So, God, that's fuzzy too. Okay, so let's assume for simplicity that a baseball field is sort of a quadrant, and it's 300 feet, radius 300 feet, and the infield has radius 100 feet. So you can just go do a little computation, and you can see that the outfield has area roughly 60,000 square feet. It's just one quarter of the ball of radius 300 minus one quarter of the area of the ball of radius 100, and you get about 60,000. So you can figure if you had three outfielders, they could cover about 20,000 square feet. They could cover most of the outfield. And you know, in baseball, they do a pretty good job of covering most of the outfields. That's probably a good guess. So the first time I gave this talk where I used this slide was during the World Series that the Red Sox won. So we got to make a lot of jokes about whether Manny could really cover 20,000 square feet. So now what happens if we do the same calculation in hyperbolic space? Well, you take one quarter of the area of ball of hyperbolic radius 300. Well, that's roughly pi over 4 times e to the 300. So that has more than 100 digits, that number. And then if you remove the outfield, well, the outfield just has area roughly pi over 4 e to the 100. So that only has 30 or 40 digits. So you're subtracting a 30 or 40 digit number from a 100 digit number. And you see that the area of the outfield, well, it's got at least 99 digits. It's at least 10 to the 99. So what does this tell you? Now, if you're baseball players can cover 20,000 square feet, how many of them do you need? Well, you need about, this is a huge underestimate. In fact, you need much more than 10 to the 94. But 10 to the 94 at least gives you some flavor for how many outfielders you need to play baseball. So for instance, one thing you can tell immediately about hyperbolic space is that there will be no Disney movies about having a family big enough to field a baseball team. I was asked not to discuss reproduction in hyperbolic space, so we could won't go into that. Okay. Well, how about golf? There's Tiger. So this image made Carol kind of nervous because I couldn't figure out where it was from. So if you took this picture and you're watching, please don't sue me or Carol. We would really appreciate that. Now suppose you've hit a really nice drive, you're exactly 100 yards from the hole, and by the way, you might ask yourself, why are the units here feet? Well, that's because we're working in American hyperbolic space. In European hyperbolic space, the units are meters. So, I'm gonna stop talking about the math and just tell the jokes. It's more fun. Okay, so you know, suppose you're exactly 300 feet from the target, and you hit it exactly 300 feet. That's just about what I do usually when I play golf. I hit it exactly the 300 feet, and I'm about 1 degree off. So, you know, you're feeling pretty good about that. And how might you attempt to estimate how far you were away? Well, you might say that I look at the circle of radius 300, and I would travel along that circle 1 degree. So if I travel along the circle, the distance would be 1/360th of the radius of the circle. So it's 2 pi. The radius of the circle is 2 pi times 300 divided by 360. You get about 5.2 feet. And it turns out that that actually is correct to decimal places, because if you travel along a circle in Euclidean space, that's really fairly efficient. I mean, if you travel along a small arc of a circle, that's not that much worse than traveling along a line. So this is a feature of Euclidean space we sort of take for granted. And even if you, you know, had to go all the way around the outside of a circle, you know, it's not so bad. You're only really off by a factor of pi of going straight through the middle of the disk. So that's really a pretty good shot. Tiger's happy over there. I think he's happy. Sort of in between. So what if you do the same estimate in hyperbolic space? Well, we take a hyperbolic circle of radius 300, and we travel 1/360th around the circle, and we get 2 pi sinh 300 over 360. Well, that's bigger than 10 to the 100th. Okay, so you can tell one thing about this, that this can't possibly be the actual distance, because you started 300 feet from the hole, you hit it 300 feet, you can't be more than 600 feet from the hole. So first of all, you know right away that even traveling along a very small degree arc of a circle in hyperbolic space is really horribly inefficient. I mean, so even if I started, you know, out on the boundary of the circle and walked all the way back into the center, which was 300 feet, and then walked all the way back out, another 300 would be 600 feet. And if I try to walk along the circle, 10 to the 100 feet, I might starve even with a very copious supply of donuts attempting to make the trip. So yeah, that's just what I said. Since your ball is no more than 600 feet from the hole, this is wrong. And you can do actually a quick calculation, which is that, and you can find out that in fact, you turn out that you're 590 feet from the hole. A little more than 590 feet from the hole. So it turns out that you really have to be very accurate in hyperbolic space. You know, being 1 degree off is really just about as bad as turning around and hitting it backwards. If you turn around and hit it backwards, you'd be 600 feet from the hole. If you hit it exactly the right distance and 1 foot away, and 1 degree off. Actually, this might be good for me, because then when I hit those little dribblers off the thing, they'd actually be better than hitting it 1 degree off. I don't know why the picture is so fuzzy. That's Tiger doing this, which is what you do when you're about to hit someone in the gallery, and you're gonna, you know, have to give them a free golf ball, you do this. Okay. Minnie and Mickey are sort of washed out. This is funny. So what about beach ball? I'm not sure whether beach ball is really a sport, but let's talk about beach ball. So what this is really illustrated is what is it like to see in hyperbolic space? And so why is it that we can see mountains that are very far away, but we can't see, say, cars that are very far away? Well, it's because the mountain is so big, it takes up a very large proportion of our field of vision. So things are visible to us if they take up a very large proportion of the set of directions we're looking in. So just to sort of imagine we're sort of a two-dimensional person, and our view at length R is just sort of a semicircle of length R. And so something, we can see something if it takes up a large proportion of that semicircle of, of radius r. So if you have sort of a beach ball, which is exactly 1 foot, it takes up 1 over pi times, the total field of vision is pi times r, and it takes up 1 of that. So it takes 1 over pi r of our field of vision. If the ball is Frankie and Annette, not in Michigan. So if the ball is 30 feet away, you can do a calculation, and it takes up roughly 1% of our field of vision. So we can certainly see anything that takes up 1% of our field of vision. And if I look out in the audience here, about every audience member takes up maybe, a quarter of a percent of my field of vision, and I can see them fine. So even if the beach ball is 300 feet away, it takes up 0.1%, or a tenth of a percent of your field of vision. And you can see a beach ball about 300 feet away, but clearly, if it was 3,000 feet away, it's going to take up 0.01% of your field of vision. You can't see beach balls 300 feet away. So this suggests sort of experimentally that you can see things up until they take up about 0.1, and you certainly can't see them at about 0.01% of your field of vision. So what happens when we're looking at beach balls in hyperbolic space? One thing is your field of vision out at radius r is much bigger. Now it's roughly pi e to the r, or I guess since we're only looking in half the circle, 1 over pi over 2 e to the r. So if the beach ball is 30 feet away from you in hyperbolic space, it's taking up about 0.0000001% of your field of vision. So the beach ball 30 feet from you, you can't possibly see in hyperbolic space. So if you assume that you can see things, and I was very generous, about 0.01%, then that beach ball becomes visible when it's about 7 feet from you. So, this sort of brings us cycling back to baseball a bit, because if you imagine, in baseball, someone's throwing a baseball at you at 100 miles per hour, and you can't see it till it's 7 feet from you, you have very little chance of ever hitting that baseball. But on the other hand, as we saw from the Tiger Woods, from the golf example, there's almost no chance that the baseball is going to come anywhere near you. First of all, he's 100 feet away, which means he's got to throw it with degree of accuracy of about 0.0001 degrees to actually get it anywhere near the strike zone. And to make this feat harder, we said that you can't see things which are very far away. So you couldn't see a baseball more than 7 feet away. You certainly can't see a person more than, say, 9 or 10 feet away. So he has to be accurate to within 0.001 degrees, and he can't see you. So at first you're very scared that he's throwing it this fast and you can't see it, but you don't even know he exists. He doesn't know you exist. Sort of problematic. Okay. Sometimes at this point in the talk, I like to sort of, discuss other sports or take questions to the audience. And I did get, so it's a little bit hard in this bigger crowd, maybe we'll do it in a minute, but I did get an email yesterday from someone asking me if I was going to talk about soccer. I wasn't planning to talk about soccer, but it got me thinking about soccer, and I realized soccer could illustrate some other things about the hyperbolic plane. One of the other defining features of non-Euclidean geometry is that if you take a triangle in non-Euclidean geometry, and it has angles alpha, beta, and gamma. Those are the angles of the triangle. And now, I've been using Euclidean angles, but let's switch to radians. Is that okay to switch to radians? Okay. If not, anyway, I'm doing it anyway, I guess. So, turns out that if this is the triangle here, the area of the triangle is pi minus alpha plus beta plus gamma. So that's the formula for the area of a triangle in hyperbolic space. Well, this is sort of a defining feature of sort of negatively curved spaces in general. That you have an inequality, not an equality. But one thing you might notice just simply is that the area of a triangle is less than pi. Right? No matter how big you make the triangle. You know, if you... you sort of see... If you make a triangle and you make sort of the endpoints of the triangle way out here, that still the triangle sort of comes in. Those aren't supposed to cross. comes in and it comes close to itself. Let's see, I have some pictures of triangles, I think. Don't want to spoil the talk. Yeah, so there's an actual picture of a hyperbolic triangle. And the area is always less than pi, no matter how far apart you make the vertices. Now, what does this mean? This means that the area of a soccer field, well, a soccer field is a rectangle. And a rectangle is just made up of two triangles. So what is the area of a hyperbolic soccer field? It's at most 2 pi. So, you know, it's around 6. So if you've got 20-some players, you want to fit on your soccer field, which has area 6, this is going to be a problem. So this is going to be a big problem for soccer, is that you can't actually fit the players on the field. You know, maybe you could have one player from each team on the field. And another thing, which seems relevant to this, which illustrates another key property of a hyperbolic space. So you've got a rectangle here. What are these? Are like, I looked this up. I think it's 180 feet. That if we're, this presumably these are American soccer fields. I doubt if European soccer fields are 180 feet, but this is what I looked up on the web. And you have this guy over here is also 180 feet. And the sides joining them have length about 100 yards, they said, so 300. Well, the picture is sort of more like that. So if you look at the width here, this is, let me try to write bigger. Width is approximately e to the negative 150 times 180. So the soccer field is really extremely narrow. So you could imagine that you have, you know, your soccer player over here, and you got your one soccer player over there. This is actually a reasonably good representation. The area will be a little less than 2 pi, and most of it will be concentrated here and here, and in the middle it will get very narrow. And so you could put one soccer player here, one soccer player there, and if they attempt to kick the ball from here to here, the odds seem quite low that the ball will not go out of bounds. Right? I mean, you know, if you're going to, you have to keep it. Now, after I got this email, I was discussing this at lunch, and I said I was going to add soccer and do this, And I had a European colleague, and he spoiled everything by pointing out to me that, you know, the line is actually in bounds in soccer. Because I was going to say that this is that the soccer ball point of contact with the earth is bigger than this, so the soccer ball will always hit one of the lines as it passes through here. But the line is in bounds, so.
It
could go in the air. So you're going to do these. Right, you're gonna do. But you know, I'm working in the hyperbolic plane. There is no air, so. Yeah.
I gotta know: do the dimensions of the soccer player change as they move through the space, or are they constantly the same height?
I imagine that they're the same soccer player. Yeah. So it's like when we had that Escher print with the fish. The fish look to our Euclidean eyes to have quite different sizes. But, you know, the fish are fish, so they think they're the same size. And from a hyperbolic viewpoint, those fish are exactly the same size. The point is that when we draw this model of hyperbolic space within a disk, it's just a model. So it distorts the actual features. We can't actually draw a picture of hyperbolic space on hyperbolic paper because we don't have any. So, right. So actually, you know, I was thinking more like, you know, you can imagine the same thing with a racquetball court. If you had a racquetball court, then you would have the back wall and the front wall, and it would get really narrow in the middle. And whenever you tried to hit the ball, you know, it would get stuck. And it would not be a very good game. Actually, that's one of the challenges when I started thinking about this talk, is to come up with a sport which actually you could actually do in hyperbolic space. You know, because if you think about it, you can't even really go for a walk in hyperbolic space. Right, because if you walk, you get about 15, 20 feet from home. You can't see your house anymore. And you know, if you're just walking around the block, now who, you know, you have to, if you walk around the block and if you're not 100% totally accurate, then you don't come back anywhere near your house. I mean, so you walk 100 feet. If I walk 100 feet, you know, even if I'm sober, I'm probably off by a degree, you know. And you know, I walk another 100 feet, I'm off by a degree, and you can sort of see how the whole thing would multiply before you know it. If you're off by 1 degree each time, I think if you did the calculation, you'd be tempted to go, you know, go 100 feet right angle, 100 feet right angle, 100 feet right angle, off by a degree, you'd be probably well over 300 feet from home at the end. Yeah.
I'm curious. Earlier you said the shortest straight line is defined as the shortest distance between two points.
Right.
But you're telling me that you can go, for example, 300 feet and end up 10 to 10 feet away from where you are.
Oh, well, you see, Well, you know, the point is that, yeah, let me draw a picture of that, of what happened there. So here was 300, here was 300, and if I measure this length, if that's 1 degree, this length is roughly 10 to the 100. But if you actually travel along the line from this point, it doesn't track the circle at all well. So the line here is about 590. So right, circles, so we're used to in Euclidean space, circles behave sort of, you know, reasonably close approximation to lines on small scale. And, well, I guess that's true on small enough scale in hyperbolic space too, you gotta get a lot smaller. So this is sort of the picture. This calculation was if I traveled along the circle instead of traveling along the line. Well, you know, that's a good question. So one thing you might do is you might say, well, I live in hyperbolic space. My ball better not be 6 inches wide. I think there's sort of, you could have a whole discussion of how would you change the rules of the sport to make them playable. So if you attempted to play them with a ball of radius about 0.5, and then as you're kicking it, it's going to stay hyperbolic radius 0.5, and it's going to go out of bounds. But maybe you can make the ball smaller, you can make the ball change sizes, you can do different things, I guess. Yeah?
Let me ask my question another way. Remember the Escher print?
Yeah.
That big fish in the middle? If that big fish started to swim towards the boundary, would it stay at the same size, or would it shrink down to a smaller size?
Well, no, because it's the same size from a hyperbolic viewpoint. So in other words, it looks in our Euclidean picture like it's a smaller fish, but within hyperbolic space, it's a fish of say length 1 foot.
Could you maybe draw in the disk model of hyperbolic space what soccer ball shape would look like as you moved it towards the edge of the world?
Right. So one thing about the disk model is that it's conformal, which is the balls always look like balls. So if you take a ball, So this is hyperbolic radius one ball. Now if you go here, and if you're out here, and if this distance is Euclidean distance d, this guy has hyperbolic radius one, but Euclidean radius one over d, roughly. Okay, so it's gonna look from our Euclidean eyes like it has size one over d, where d is the distance to the boundary, but from the hyperbolic viewpoint, it's still a ball of radius one. Okay, I think I better move along a little bit. I got to get to the drive-by truckers. We got business. Okay. So you might ask yourself, well, what are all the geometries? What properties does a geometry have? If I just say a geometry is a way of measuring distances, that allows a vast cloud of spaces called metric spaces, and there's just way too many to discuss. So one thing we might say is the geometry is nice if it looks the same at every point. Means so that if you're, you know, like if you're in Euclidean space, if you look around, everything looks about the same at this point as it does that point over there. Maybe we'll. And hyperbolic space is nice, and I think I will skip the description of why. You can ask me about it later if you'd like to. And then you can say a space is. So there are, in fact, only three nice geometric spaces. One is Euclidean space, which we presumably live in. Though actually, we locally think we live in Euclidean space. And sometimes this is one thing physicists can do, is they can sort of look at what is the large-scale geometry of the universe. And it's not clear a priori that it's Euclidean, even though it looks quite Euclidean on this scale. It's a whole other story. Euclidean space, spherical space. The sphere has a perfectly nice geometry. You take a two-dimensional sphere. You know, what are the lines? The lines on the two-dimensional sphere are just the great circles. We can talk about angles. We can do all sorts of things. And hyperbolic space, which I told you. And up to scaling, those are the only ones. And they also have the property that they're very nice, which means not only they look the same at every point, but they look the same in every direction. So. Yeah. Okay, so one thing that's a characteristic of this of spherical geometry, which is sort of positively curved, is that if you look at a triangle, the area adds up to more than pi, or more than 180 degrees. So if you look at this sort of the octant of the sphere there, that triangle has three right angles. So it adds up to 270 degrees. And the smaller you make the triangle, the closer that the sum of the angles is to just 180 degrees. And in hyperbolic space, well, this formula suggests to you they better add up to less than 180 degrees, or else the area would be negative, and that would be problematic. And you can sort of see that each time the hyperbolic triangle with those endpoints actually lies inside the Euclidean triangle with those same endpoints. So in fact, the angles must have gotten smaller. So it must have gotten less than pi. Okay? So now let's talk about surfaces a little bit. That's the second part of the title, the geometry of surfaces. And what are surfaces? Surfaces are things which look locally like two-dimensional space. Or you can think about making them with construction paper and gluing up construction paper. And we're going to assume that we do this gluing in a three-dimensional space to make life easier. And we're going to assume we don't need leave any loose edges. And so you can sort of glue up and make a ball. You can glue up, you can make a donut. You can glue up, you can make a donut with two holes, three holes, et cetera. So what is the natural geometry of these surfaces? Well, the sphere, we can guess what geometry the sphere should have. The sphere has spherical geometry, right? Okay, almost a tautology. But what about the torus, the donut with one hole? Well, it actually has Euclidean geometry. Because you can make it by taking a sheet of Euclidean paper and gluing the top to the bottom and the left to the right. Now, if you actually attempt to do this in Euclidean space, you're going to have to bend it and distort the geometry. This is a theorem of Hilbert, I think. But, you know, if this is just our description of the space, we know how to live in that space, and you should sort of be used to doing this, right? You know, if you're the right age, you played Asteroids, and Asteroids is played on a torus with a Euclidean structure. It looks locally like Euclidean space. You go, your little asteroid goes off the top on a line going this way. The asteroid comes back in the bottom going that way. And you'll notice here that if you look at that, the only point you might sort of worry about is that vertex point. But what does it look like at that vertex point? It looks like you glued four little quadrants of Euclidean space together. So the total angle is 360 degrees. So really, if you look at the geometry of the surface, and if you just live on that surface and you say you're an ant and you can't see very far, you just think you're in the Euclidean plane. You never see around to the other side. So this is called putting a Euclidean structure on this on the torus. And that's here's a picture of a little guy gluing up, taking the paper, gluing it up by gluing the top to the bottom, putting some glue on it, bending it around, and gluing the left to the right. So you can sort of imagine it. But like I said, I think, you know, if you play, now that we have video games, this is much easier to explain to people. They sort of, oh yeah, that's how video games work. Now, what about a surface of genus 2? That's a little bit harder. Don't worry about exactly understanding this diagram, but you can imagine how would you figure out that the torus was a glued up square? You might first draw an arc going once around the circle this way, and then draw one once around the circle that way, and I would cut along it, and what would be left over would be a square. So I could sort of reverse the process. So that's what I've done here. I've drawn a bunch of loops on my surface of genus 2, and if I cut along them, if I draw enough loops and I cut along them, what's left over is going to turn out to be an octagon. It's going to have 8 sides, and there's going to be some diagram, and those arrows are supposed to tell you how to glue it up. Now, you know, you have to stare at this a while for this to make any sense, but let me just, what I hope makes sense is that there's some way of gluing up a polygon to get the surface of genus 2. Okay? So you might think, so, well, this is great. I'm just going to take a regular Euclidean octagon, and I'm going to glue it up, and I'm going to put a Euclidean structure on the surface of genus 2. Well, what's the problem with that? Well, then, that octagon, you get 8 little pieces of that octagon, all around there. So what's the total angle of an octagon? It's 1,080 degrees. So if you glue up a Euclidean octagon this way, at that point it looks very bad. It takes 1,080 degrees to travel around a little circle. That's no good. So what's a great thing? So you need an octagon where each of the angles is 45 degrees. If each of the angles were 45 degrees, when you glued it up, you glue 8 of them, you get 8 times 45, that'd be 360 degrees, and you'd be happy. And we saw a nice thing about hyperbolic space is that angles are smaller than they are in Euclidean space. So in fact, in hyperbolic space, I can construct a right-angled octagon, sorry, a regular octagon, all of whose angles are 45 degrees. Like so, there's a little picture of it. And that's a tessellation. So the yellow pieces are all copies of that, are all octagons. But they look distorted. And so this is a tessellation. This picture is a tessellation of hyperbolic space by octagons. It's sort of like a more mathematical version of an Escher print. You can imagine if I stuck fish in there, it would look like an Escher print. You know, and you know, this is why Escher makes a lot more money, made a lot more money than mathematicians do, because we never think to put fish in our pictures. You know. You know what Spinal Tap said, it's a fine line between clever and stupid. Anyway, so then you glue that up and you get a hyperbolic structure on a surface genus 2. So it turns out that actually this is a really good way to study surfaces. And you can do this for all the surfaces with 2 holes, 3 holes, 4 holes. You put this hyperbolic structure on them, and the geometry allows you to study the topology. And so that's actually One of my favorite things within mathematics is using geometric tools to study topological problems, or using topological tools to study geometric problems. So sort of understanding that interplay can be really fun. So here's a dimension count. There's a lot of ways to do this. So maybe I'll skip over that quickly. So all you have to have is how many octagons are there that you could glue up and make surfaces with two holes? It turns out there's a six-dimensional space of them. And here's another sort of point of contact with physics, which luckily we're running low on time, so I can't expose the full nature of my ignorance on the subject, but let's just use the word string theory and leave it at that. And the space of structures on a surface comes up very naturally in string theory. Okay. And so it turns out that, in fact, these are all the surfaces that you can make with construction paper in three dimensions. You get the sphere, the torus with one hole, the torus with the surface with two holes, three holes, four holes, etc. That's all you can do. Now, some of you might have seen some other surfaces. Oops. I didn't plan to do this, I don't have any notes. So, it's gonna work really well in a big crowd, isn't it? So, you all know what a Möbius strip is, though. I just take this and I glue it top to bottom like that. Glue it around, funny, everybody's seen a Möbius strip. So, that's fine. Now, the boundary of a Möbius strip, there's just the one boundary component, because I go along the top and I come back along the bottom. The boundary is a circle. So I could attempt to take two Möbius strips and glue them together along their boundary circles. Now, if you try to do this, it's not hard. You can get paper and try to do it. You will find out you can't. And it's not because you're not dexterous with paper. In fact, this object, you can't do that gluing up in three-dimensional space. On the other hand, it's a perfectly good topological space. I just tell you, it's one Möbius strip and another strip, and I glue them together. It's like if I'm driving around the Midwest, and I have maps of Wisconsin and Michigan and Ohio and Indiana and Illinois. I can travel along around the Midwest perfectly well without ever gluing those maps together, right? So just the maps is a perfectly good description. So if I tell you there's this Möbius strip and this other Möbius strip here, and if you go off this Möbius strip at this point, you come in over there, that's a perfectly good mathematical description of a space. And it's something we really are sort of used to. We see it in video games. We saw it in that Asteroids game. We know that if we go off the top, we come in the bottom. And we travel around the country, we use this principle. And so, in fact, there's a whole other collection of surfaces which you can only make in four dimensions. And those are non-orientable surfaces. And so you have to actually prove a theorem to say you can embed them in three dimensions, but you can't. Okay. This just says that the same picture would work in general. If I take a surface with G holes, I can cut it along two G curves, and I get a polygon with four G sides. And when I glue it up, if I make each of the internal angles pi over 2G, I glue it back up, I get a hyperbolic structure with total angle 4G times pi over 2G, which is 2 pi, and I've made a nice hyperbolic surface of genus G. So I can do this with however many holes I want. Okay. I said I'd say a little bit about three dimensions, so we're going to go kind of quickly through here. But you can imagine doing the same thing with three dimensions. Now we don't use construction paper, now we use Lego blocks. I mean, we all have played with Lego blocks, I hope, and so you can just glue them. So a three-dimensional manifold is just something you can make by gluing together Lego blocks, and you should really allow yourself. You can't, you're really with Lego blocks, you're limiting yourself an awful lot if you only work in three-dimensional space. So let's allow ourselves to work in any dimensional space we want and just glue them up any way we want. And so a particularly nice example of this is a three-dimensional torus. You take one Lego block, you glue the top to the bottom. That seems okay. We can actually do that in three-dimensional space. And I glue this side, the left side to the right side. That's okay, I can do that in a three-dimensional space. In fact, I just get a torus. I get a thickened up torus. But now I take the front and I glue it to the back. I can't do that gluing anymore. But I get something which is three-dimensional torus. In fact, it's a product of three circles. This thing I've described is a circle cross a circle cross a circle. We're used to R cross R cross R is R3. So a circle cross a circle cross a circle. Since the circle looks like locally like the real line, circle cross the circle cross the circle looks locally like the real line cross the real line cross the real line, which is just R3. Okay. And then here's an example of a hyperbolic three-manifold. You take a dodecahedron, and you do some way of gluing it, and you make a hyperbolic dodecahedron and glue it up and put a hyperbolic structure on a three-manifold. This assumes you believe that just like Euclidean 2 space generalizes naturally to Euclidean 3 space, you take hyperbolic 2 space, and you can just make something very similar, very analogous hyperbolic 3 space. That's a picture of a dodecahedron in hyperbolic, a totally geodesic dodecahedron in hyperbolic 3 space. And if when you glue it up, here's a tessellation, here's a picture of a tessellation of hyperbolic 3 space by dodecahedra. So, kind of groovy. Okay, and now you might think to yourself, what are all the nice geometries? It turns out there's 8 three-dimensional geometries. There's the three-sphere, there's Euclidean 3 space, obviously, there's hyperbolic 3 space. Then you can take the 2-sphere and cross it with R. That has a nice geometry. It looks the same at every point. It's not very nice, because if you look in one of the spherical directions, you look around and you see your back. If you look, you know, if you're standing on a sphere across R and you look in the sphere direction, you look around, if you have really good vision, you can see your back end. But on the other hand, if you look up into the sky in the real direction, you just see forever, you never see yourself. So look, it's quite different in different directions. And then there's some other funny ones too. Don't worry about it. There's 8 of them. So you might think to yourself, oh, well, this is really good. I'm going to take every three-dimensional space, I'm going to put a geometric structure on it, and I'm going to use it to study all three-dimensional spaces. And, you know, we should feel pretty interested in studying three-dimensional spaces because we live in one. That's another question that you can ask yourself. Do we really live in something which is really just three-dimensional space, or does somehow, is it a three-dimensional torus we just can't see very far? Sort of a natural question. Again, I won't say any more to expose my ignorance. but it turns out that's too naive. So what this guy, Bill Thurston, who was the guy I worked with in graduate school, conjectured that, well, that's too naive, but there's some canonical procedure. You take any three-dimensional space, you cut it up into pieces. There's some recipe for cutting up into pieces, and each of those pieces is one you can put a nice geometric structure on. Okay, if you think, you know, this picture, it's a little scary, but then this was recently solved by, and this was you might have heard of the Poincaré conjecture. It was a $1 million prize, and it was just solved by this guy, even more scary. So he gave a complete proof of this conjecture just 3 or 4 years ago. You might have read about this in the popular press. The only time the mathematicians make the popular press is when, you know, someone kind of crazy does something. So he refused the Fields Medal. Anyway, there's a big controversy over the credit, so we actually got into the New Yorker. and this was built on the pioneering work of Richard Hamilton. And the basic idea is you put some geometry on your space. Every space admits some geometry, and you want a nice geometry. So what do? You start trying to improve the geometry. So you start a flow where you make the geometry nicer and nicer. Like, you know, suppose you had a bad curve and you wanted to, suppose you had some badly behaved curve and you wanted to make it into a nice curve. Well, you would sort of, you know, okay, I'm gonna sort of make it better. That looks more circular. You can sort of flow it towards a circle. And he used the same idea. It's complicated differential equations proof. Okay, 4 minutes. I think we can do this. Okay. So now I figured in the last 3 or 4 minutes I would just show you some pictures of things that are really things I do. Since I've really Nothing, I haven't talked about anything related to, which is directly related to my own work. And so what I study is sort of spaces of structures on three manifolds. I alluded to earlier that on a surface, there's lots of structures. And you can study that space, and that space of structures is very interesting. And in fact, very interesting to physicists. I study spaces of structures on three manifolds, and as far as I know, physicists don't care at all about spaces of hyperbolic structures on three manifolds, but I do it anyway. So here are some pictures which come up in the work. So, let's just say it's a cool picture. So this is sort of, you take a hyperbolic three manifold and you color its boundary red and you look at it from inside, and this is what you see if you're living inside your hyperbolic three manifold. And here is an explicit, so I was told earlier that they wanted to talk on, they were looking for someone to talk about fractals. I was just told, right before the talk, so there's a fractal. So this is a deformation, this is a picture of a deformation space of hyperbolics. So each point in that picture is supposed to be a hyperbolic structure on a three manifold. And it's natural to study the space of those structures. And here's more pictures of the limit sets, which are sort of, that's the boundary to infinity of the picture I just showed you before. And there's a slimy slug, nothing to do with that. Actually, this is, again, another one of these. You color your the boundary of your hyperbolic picture, hypermanifold gray, and look from inside. This is what it looks like. Looks like a slimy slug. Actually, this is you're looking at it from outside, not inside, sorry. And here's an animation of the deformation space. There we go. It's much better when it's more dramatic when you get can hear it right when it starts. It's very well timed. You get this next animation. Done.
Saturday Morning Physics is sponsored by the Physics Department of the University of Michigan, by the Dr. Remlois Tiffany Endowment, and by gifts from friends of the program.